the web is weird. It's always been weird. It's probably always going to be weird. And frankly, I like it being weird. And this exploit from Oligosecurity is the kind of weirdness I expect to see. 0.0.0 day, exploiting localhost APIs from the browser. This vulnerability allows malicious websites to bypass browser security and interact with services running on an organization's local network, potentially leading to unauthorized access and remote code execution on local services by attackers outside the network. Now, the remote code execution is going to depend entirely on what is running on your system. But if you're running a project that has an RCE, this is going to allow malicious websites to execute that on your system in many, many cases. Even though the service you're running is not exposed to the internet and is only supposed to be running on the local host. Whilst this exploit does affect all three of the major browser engines, Chromium, Firefox, and Safari, it only affects macOS and Linux clients. Windows is unaffected. And there's a fairly good reason for that, and the Wikipedia page on 0.0.0.0 explains why it's different fairly well. This IP address can have multiple uses. It has an official use, but then different systems out there, different operating systems, use it in very, very, very different ways. This is an IP address that doesn't have a set specific meaning. According to RFC 1122, Requirements for Internet Host Communication Layers, this is supposed to mean this host on this network, and it must not be sent except as a source address as part of an initialization procedure by which the host learns its own IP address. That's the official definition. On Linux, it can be used as a remote address to connect to the current host, aka the local host. Sometimes it's used as a way to specify the target is unavailable. Sometimes as a way to route a request to a non-existent target instead of the original target. Often used for ad blocking purposes. But because this can refer to the local host on Linux, this can conflict with OS-specific behavior. And then in routing tables, 0.0.0.0 can also appear in the gateway column. This indicates that the gateway to reach the corresponding destination subset is unspecified, basically being used as a filler. The point I'm making here is yes, it has an official definition, but outside of that very specific use case, everybody just does whatever they want with it. Now, back in 2020, this article was released. Why is this website port scanning me? Whereby eBay was port scanning visitors as soon as they loaded the website. Using this technique, the website used JavaScript to scan the ports on localhost, resulting in an interesting, unique fingerprint. Because if you are running anything that is slightly uncommon, and then you combine that with all of the other fingerprinting information out there, you've pretty much got an individual match. No matter what way this is being used, it is really creepy. If it's being used by a website to identify a user that is not logged in, or if it's being used by a phishing website who is trying to sell your data. And browsers should not have the ability to send those requests in the first place. The problem is this was just the way the internet worked for years, and no one cared. It took time to fully understand that this behavior could lead to breaches, and by the time we found out, it was part of every browser and very hard to fix. So this also wasn't new in 2020. So all the way back in 2006, an 18-year-old bug report, this has been known about. In this bug report, a user claimed public websites had attacked his router in the internal network and believed websites should not be able to do so. Yeah, they probably should not be able to do that. At the time, internal networks and the internet in general were insecure by design. Many services lacked authentication, not to mention SSL certificates and HTTPS, which did not exist everywhere. Websites were loaded over insecure HTTP transport, and attackers constantly outsmart the browser for malicious purposes. And since it was known in 2006, other people did start to exploit it. Ultimately, though, an exploit on a router is caused by bad software on the router itself. It is facilitated by the browser, but if the exploit isn't in the router, even if they can access the router, there's nothing they could do to it. Just keep that in mind. 18 years have passed with hundreds of comments, but the bug remains open to this day. During these 18 years, the issue was closed, reopened, reprioritized to severe or critical, and even exploited in the wild, and all of this is due to everyone's favorite, bike shedding. People arguing about details that don't matter. Is it a vulnerability? Is it specific to Firefox? Is this a request for an enhancement instead of a bug report? What is this? It doesn't matter. It just shouldn't be there for 18 years. So clearly the web needed a better solution, and in comes Google with a better solution, private network access. For a long time, it was not clear how browsers should behave when they make requests to local or internal networks from less private contexts. So if you're going from attacker.com, should it be able to make a request to something on your local network or on the local host? The answer is, in no real world circumstance should an external website be able to contact your local host. All major browsers have relied on CORS. CORS is cross-origin resource sharing. It is a way for a web application that is loaded from one domain to interact with resources on another domain. CORS helps a lot, but its performance depends on the response content, so requests are still made and can still be sent. This is simply not good enough. History proved that a single HTTP request can attack a home router, and if that's all it takes, every user needs to be able to prevent this request from ever happening at all. So early this year in April, Google drafted Private Network Access. The new standard extends CORS by restricting the ability of websites to send requests to servers on private networks. PNA proposes to distinguish between public, private, and local networks. Pages loaded under a less secure context will not be able to communicate with more secure context. For example, attacker.com is not able to contact 127.0.0.1, which is localhost, or 192.168.1.1, which is on your local network. These IP addresses are considered more private, and it differs in a very key way from CORS. In the case of CORS, it relies on the response saying, hey, you're not allowed to contact me. In this case, it blocks the request from ever being sent. And here we have a list of addresses and address ranges that are considered either local or private, so an external domain is not able to contact these. Most of these make sense, but there is one very important missing IP address. 0.0.0.0. So we ran a dummy HTTP server on localhost. We then tried to access it through an external domain from JavaScript using 0.0.0.0. It simply worked. The request reached the server. So it's trying to connect to 0.0.0.0 in the JavaScript running on your browser, but it was loaded from an external website. And it just did it. That shouldn't be happening. Now, CORS did its job and the response was blocked. But if you don't care about the response, all you care about is accessing that port with a dangerous payload, that's all you need. We understood this was a bypass of the current PNA implementation and an inherent flaw in browsers. We reported what we found to all browsers following reasonable disclosure, but we needed a real threat and a real attack vector to prove our point. To find a local application that would be vulnerable from the browser, first we needed an HTTP server that runs on a local port, local host network interface. Now you might think, oh, under what situation would a random person just be running an HTTP server? Well, there is a lot of applications that have a web interface that are accessible from the browser. This is not an uncommon issue. To fully exploit that vulnerability by gaining remote code execution, we needed the service to have an HTTP route that we could write, tweak, or modify files and configurations. again, we were spoiled for choice. Real-world applications have many endpoints, and oftentimes local services don't exactly care about security because they're local services. It's assumed that it's only going to be local. Why put focus into securing it? Our first vulnerable application, Ray. This is an AI framework that maybe you as a regular user aren't going to be running, but you might be running if you're a big business. Proof of concept, Shadow Ray from the browser. Shadow Ray, a recent attack campaign targeting AI workloads, was discovered by Oligo in the wild. Our researchers have now proven that it is possible to execute this attack from the browser using 0.0.0.0 as the attack vector. Shadow Ray enabled arbitrary code execution when intentionally exposed to the internet and went undiscovered for nearly a year. As big fans of Ray, we've often used it locally for development. With that in mind, we asked ourselves, could a public website exploit a Ray cluster running on localhost? Explanation. First, in the right terminal, we run a Ray cluster on localhost. Then, on the left terminal, we start a socket that is listening to new connections, to open a reverse shell. Then the victim clicks on the link in the email, which runs the exploit. Exploit runs a reverse shell for the attacker on the visitor's machine. You don't have to interact with anything on the website. All you need to do is connect to it. Second attack, Selenium Grid, which is an attack on the Selenium Grid test framework. This, once again, is an RCE vulnerability. On local Selenium Grid instances, we discover the RCE is possible when dispatching a POST request to 0.0.0.0 with the port that Selenium Grid is running on with a crafted payload. And another interesting attack vector, using the local Selenium Grid cluster to browse to websites using the insecure browser configurations to gain access to internal domains and private DNS records behind a VPN. And the third one is ShellTorch, which affected PyTorch TorchServe. And once again, is basically the same deal. Now the big question is whether or not this is a major exploit that everybody should be worried about. Kinda, yeah, maybe. So, when it comes to the port scanning aspect, yes, that is a big deal. And yes, that is a fingerprinting problem. Now, fingerprinting was already very possible without doing the port scanning. Adding the port scanning in there, and that becomes basically a guarantee to individually identify who you actually are. When it comes to the whole accessing services that are running on localhost, doing RCEs and things like that, yes, if you are running a project that has an RCE. Just because you are running it on localhost does not mean that RCE cannot actually be exploited from an external party. In that case, yes, it is a very, very big deal. Are there many cases where things like this sit around for a long time without being resolved? Sometimes, just not every single thing you're running. It's not like every single HTTP server you're running on localhost is going to cause this to happen. Personally, I would be a lot more concerned about the port scanning. But considering it's been going on for 18 years now, anyone who was gonna do the port scanning already was already doing so. Now, following this being reported, most of the browsers are going ahead and dealing with this. In Chromium, deprecate 0.0.0.0 for private network access. Over in Safari land, whilst we can't look at Safari directly, we can look at WebKit. Block connections to 0.0.0.0.0. Thinking back on it, I don't know how many times I forgot that final zero. Now, in the Firefox case, there is a change to the fetch standard to block that IP address. There is currently not a change being worked on, at least that I know about, in Firefox itself. So at an undetermined point in the future, it'll probably be blocked in Firefox as well. So unless you're running a project that has a known RCE and it has an HTTP server that can be used to exploit it, I wouldn't really worry about this. But what do you think? Do you think it actually is a really big deal and everybody should be terrified? I would love to know. So if you liked the video, go like the video. And if you really liked the video and you want to become one of these amazing people over here, check out the Patreon, Scribes, and Pay link in the description down below. That's going to be it for me, and the web is weird. Like this.